Good evening. I'd like to call this meeting to order. I would like to welcome you to the June 2019 meeting of the City of Reading's Historical Architectural Review Board. Thank you for your attendance this evening. Chapter 295 of the City of Reading's Codified Ordinances requires that the HARB be guided by the United States Secretary of the Interior Standards for Rehabilitation and Guidelines for Rehabilitating Historic Buildings, Chapter 180, Construction Codes, and by any policies and or guidelines hereafter adopted by the Board or the City of Reading. While meetings of the HARB are generally informal, Robert's Rules of Order are used to structure the proceedings and maintain decorum. All attendees are asked to turn off cell phones and electronic devices until adjournment of the meeting. The audio portion of these proceedings will be recorded for record-keeping purposes. When an applicant hears the name of his or her property called by the chair, they should come to the front, sign in on the sign-in sheet, and wait for the preservation officer to present a summary of the application proposal. The chair will recognize the applicant when the time is appropriate for him or her to present any supporting information to the board. Applicants are asked to limit their presentation to 3 minutes. February and March 2019 minutes were distributed previously and then yesterday. And are there any corrections to the minutes? Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Are there any conflicts of interest for tonight's agenda? No? Okay. Okay, so if we could have an applicant who's already there. Okay, you already signed in?
Yes, ma'am.
You know the drill, right? Okay, good. So this is 1344 Good Street.
The subject property is located in the Penns Common Historic District. The building is a three-story, semi-detached dwelling and features a coarse stone facade, a bay window at the second floor front facade, and a leaded glass transom depicting the building's address above the first floor entrance door. The historic integrity of the structure has been compromised with the application of aluminum capping at wood surfaces on the front facade and the replacement of the original wood railing and support posts with a wrought iron railing system at the first floor front porch. The structure received a site quality rating of 82, deeming it a contributing building in the district. And the Secretary of the Interior standards that apply to the project consisting of renovation of the first floor front porch is our standards number 2, which states the historic character of a property shall be retained and preserved. The removal of historic materials or alteration of features and spaces that characterize a property shall be avoided. Number 5, distinctive features, finishes, and construction techniques or examples of craftsmanship that characterize a historic property shall be preserved. And number 6, deteriorated historic features shall be repaired rather than replaced. Where the severity of deterioration requires replacement of a distinctive feature, the new feature shall match the old in design, color, texture, and other visual qualities, and where possible, materials. Replacement of missing features shall be substantiated by documentary, physical, or pictorial evidence.
Okay, you're welcome to walk through the proposal this evening.
Okay. We were responding to the last rulings of the meeting, and so I took it back and redrew everything to meet as much as we possibly could with trying to keep it, still trying to keep it somewhat economical for the client. And so I think I've addressed everything as far as from a, recreating some crown moldings and the cornice detail. We went with a flat shingle roof versus the architecturals, which are a little out of place. Mm-hmm. And then the we ended up putting the wrought, another version of the wrought iron, the faux wrought iron back, because of more or less from an economic point of view, because it would have been a little difficult for our customer for the columns. And it just seemed to work out a little better for us. And then I did create a recessed gutter detail that should meet.
Okay. Does the board have some questions?
I just want to thank you for going back and answering Amy's questions that the executive committee had, because it made it a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it'll save a lot of time. The only question I had was the gutter, the downspout. You have that it was either going to be a 2x3 aluminum or a round, and you answered that it's going to be white, but you didn't say whether it was going to be the 2x3 or the round gutter.
It was one of those things that tonight, upon recommendation from the board, what you would prefer to see there, and that's what we'll install there for you.
Board have exceptions to any of the proposal, like materials? I know there's some aluminum, I believe, that's being used on the side of the porches, which is a little different from what we asked for, but I think that's probably something worthy of discussion. And but I mean, if the board is good with most things, maybe we just talk about the things that we might have some questions about.
Well, the gutter, typically we'd be looking for half round with concealed brackets.
This is just the downspout, I believe.
We're talking about the
downspout. Just the downspout, because I believe at the last meeting it was required of us to have a built-in gutter, opposed to the half round gutter with the hangers.
I'm sorry, I'm confused. One of your details shows a built-in gutter and the other does not. So what is being proposed?
We propose that the built-in gutter as required from the last meeting.
Okay.
Where does it show an external gutter?
Well, there's a detail that has no gutter at all.
Could you tell me which page that is?
Open up our prints.
I don't have a set of prints to reference.
Here.
Oh. What sheet is that?
The sheet A7. And sheet A4.
Okay, A7 is showing two different things. I did a blow-up of the very eave to show you a full-size section of the crown molding. That's the left side full-scale trim detail. Okay. And then the one on the right shows the recessed gutter. That's a... And actually, it does say built-in gutter if you look at it. It's just such a blow-up that you don't really see the whole thing. Then on A4...
On the left side, it does show the built-in gutter again.
And you won't see it on the right elevation because it's a side view and the gutter is built into the roof. So you don't see the gutter from the left, right, or the right. It's built into the plane of the roof.
Okay.
So
we would not have an exception to the built-in gutter. That's what previously existed. In fact, are there certain items that can be pulled from the resolution because they're in-kind replacements?
Yeah, actually the metal railing is pretty close, and the built-in gutter.
The only question I had about the molding was, it looks like your rake detail differs slightly from what had previously existed, which I believe had a crown.
It was hard to tell what was on the rake of that, sir, due to the fact that it was actually capped in aluminum.
Right. So it looked like the cornice return on the existing porch roof had a crown molding that came down the rake, the crown molding across the front fascia. They met at the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was also a cornice return that continued back horizontally. So you have these three pieces coming together at the cornice return, which is fairly common.
And I think that's what I have. If you look at my either the right or left elevation drawing, I forget what number that's.
A9.
Well, see, it'll show better on the flat view. There you go. If you look at A4, I have a 3-inch crown mold coming down the rake of the drip edge on top of the face board or the frieze, I guess. It's a rake board. And then underneath that, I have another 3-inch AZEK molding that comes down and will meet the. It gets mitered on top of the return molding, which is a 5-inch. It's on that cornice that returns. And then I put a 1x4 AZEK cap on top of it to give it a kill point, so it will actually project out. Might be a little difficult to see on the drawings. I'm not sure if any of my blow-ups show it any better. That one shows it half decent.
No.
Actually, A4 seems to show it the best.
So I think what I'm reacting to is on the front fascia, you have two crown moldings, and they don't come together at the corner the way that they would have. So like if you look at the historical, the photo of the existing condition, all three moldings are coming together at the corner, which is pretty typical. You've got the rake and the fascia coming together, and then your cornice return actually sneaks around underneath the fascia and creates like a second tier of cornice line.
Yeah, they have theirs combined. Let me see that. Yeah, I actually have two tiers.
So I
kind of did that because of the way it worked with my built-in gutter detail.
So I think you want it to look something like this when it's all finished. So your rake board would actually die into the cornice return.
Into the roof line and then that return beam.
Right.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. I just held mine up a little differently. I actually am bringing my drip crown straight across with that piece of molding on top of the beam. Or maybe I'm not. Let's see that. No, it's not showing right.
I think in order to make it work, you may have to bird's mouth the rafters to get them to sit down a little bit more on that beam. And then you might have to upsize the crown molding on the rake and the fascia. So your 5-inch might actually be closer to what was there before. And by beefing that up a little bit, it may actually get them all to line up at the corner.
To line up and just return that roof line just past that corner.
Right.
Yeah, I didn't have the advantage of being able to take any measurements because it was gone. You know what I mean?
Do we have a neighboring property that still has that detail?
I think it's different.
I think the neighboring property is capped aluminum. Looking at the photos that we have here.
And it's smaller.
Okay, this is actually a good photo though. I mean, that's definitely, if that drip edge is an inch and a half, that crown molding's got to be 5 inches.
Here. I thought I had it crowned at 3 and change. I'm not disagreeing. I'm just trying to get it figured out to where we can do the right thing.
This is the other end, Aaron. That is my original. That shows
I'm not sure what.
Oh, there's one exposed.
That's not.
So your fascia molding should just come, make a 90 degree return back to the wall, and then your rake trim should die into the top of that.
What I need to do is just bring another molding up even with that one and go across, and then we'll probably have to still have a crown. The way they did it, they have a crown to a crown, kind of.
Right.
So I might have to put a crown there, you know, the crown that I have, and
that's right. Yeah,
maybe make this a bigger molding and come across with it like that and put that little roof head over top of it.
Right. I think they're all the same size molding. They're all crowns. It's mm-hmm. just, I think you're, in order
to
get your framing down low enough, you're going to have to cut a bird's mouth in that.
In the rafters. To drop it down further on
right.
the beam.
Yeah, that sets my gutter back a little funny. I mean, I think I can make it work. Either way, you know what I mean? Try to.
I see what you mean. Yeah. Your gutter actually may have to come out proud of the beam to make that work.
Or it would have to possibly go back.
Yeah, it could go back inside there, too.
Yeah. Now, along the lines of what you had mentioned earlier, are you saying that it would be allowed to do a half-round gutter? Because that would make things a little bit easier to get everything to line up there. If you're saying that it would be allowed to go back with half-round gutter and hangers, that would make that detail a little easier to accomplish.
We've approved them in the past. I think the issue with your condition is you had a concealed gutter, and that's where that's what the resolution was about from the last meeting.
Okay.
Matching the existing condition.
Which is consistent with what's probably originally in the block.
What is the pitch on 4 and 12?
It played out to about a 412.
So if you drop that down a little bit, you may end up with closer to like a 4.5 and 12. Mm-hmm. I think it'll help. I think bringing those moldings together at the corner will help it aesthetically. It's certainly more historically appropriate. And then the only question is, situating that gutter in there, if we can't get it either in front of or behind the beam, do you have any idea where it was previously?
It's hard to tell really what was, because obviously there was no sheeting, no nothing. Everything was obviously in total disarray. It was hard to get a feel for where it was. It really was, because there was so much missing when we first went there.
I mean, I can. If I take this piece of molding here, where it meets at the eave, and go straight across, mire it in like you would expect, and then that rake molding will come down.
Exactly.
Top of it. I can have a little bit of a, almost like a, not a freeze, but you call it a, like an architrave kind of situation, mm-hmm. where there might be a piece of flat there going back, and then that other piece of molding that's under the beam would meet that and go straight back too. So it would create a simple, in other words, the corners would meet right here of the rectilinear piece. It would probably be maybe an inch and a half, 2 inch piece of flat. Mm-hmm. And then it wouldn't be the exact detail, but it would be getting us in that.
Yeah, that would be workable. In fact, that's what's happening in this image. That's exactly what's happening.
Yeah, where they have that mm-hmm. little flat area.
Yeah,
I mean, it's not identical. They did a beefy crown to a crown, and they just had it meet at the roof. But you can see that in the photograph. But we could do that to get it, you know, get it nicer. And then I could leave my structure intact.
That would be historically appropriate. What you're proposing.
Okay. And I can do that with just another piece of AZAC.
Yeah.
Like a piece of 1x4 or something. Or actually, on those corners, I was proposing to use the aluminum in places where it doesn't stand out and look like aluminum, like you're not wrapping around a piece of trim, which really is ugly.
Right.
And so you get a nice sharp corner. It's waterproof. It's a little more economical detail. but it gets offset by the fact that you use a crown, and a crown that gives it that chunk and that beef, so it wouldn't, you know, in my mind, I don't think the aluminum there would stand out.
I don't mind it if it has, if it's held in place by the AZEK continuously. You shouldn't really see like oil canning or pop rivets or things like that.
I don't think so. And I am wrapping the beam entirely in AZEK. I don't know if you noticed that or not. The carrier, the main beam and the return beams are entirely in AZEK. So I'm trying to put a little, you know, the nicer stuff forward a little bit. So, you know, it just, I think it'll throw, your eye won't pick up on any of that aluminum. I mean, and if it does, I don't think it's that much.
This is the
This is the wood.
Right, that's the wood. Okay.
Do you know if by chance the homeowner has discussed painting any of those roof lines or anything?
We haven't had a discussion about it. Okay. We've been honestly focused on getting through this portion.
Right.
So
just thinking ahead that maybe he's doing some kind of color scheme or something like that we want to include in our resolution to say any colors we approve.
Right. Anything he would do after this portion of things, he would obviously have to go through you folks.
Yeah. Just was wondering. We want to include that you know, if he does so decide to paint later on, he wants to come back.
Okay.
We were just
there hasn't been any discussion about that though.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we're implying white the whole way so far, just in lieu of going through all that. And if he would go with a color, he'd have to paint the AZEK then,
right?
Unless there were white detailing.
Could tie that in.
You know, with the aluminum, we can get a variety of colors if he would pick a color. Mm-hmm. You know.
Our plan is to go with the white to make things simpler for everybody.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he may not even want to paint.
Correct. Yeah. And I'm thinking he's thinking more maintenance free. So if we do all these types of materials, that he doesn't have the maintenance and the repainting,
right? Which doesn't require it.
And then the other materials that are being introduced are 3-tab shingles on the porch roof, the CertainTeed triple to beaded soffit, and what's the other one? Oh, the wood clapboard on the gable ends,
which would be painted.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Would that be painted white for now?
Yes.
For now, yeah. Okay. We would probably put it up primed, maybe.
It would be finished when we're done.
Okay.
It would be a finished coat paint.
Same with the underneath as well.
The underneath, what we propose doing is a triple tube vinyl, which is a maintenance free. We did bring some samples if you'd like to see them.
Okay.
So once again, it's more of that along the lines of that maintenance free with the AZEK and the things that we proposed.
I can hand that around. It's the idea being that it's underneath.
Mm-hmm.
It's not out front. It's not facing this way. Everything that's facing, you know, when it's like that, sloping away from you, this is a lot more economical way to buy, B, to install, and then it's done. And you would never have them coming back with gaps. I mean, it's not going to crack on. I think from a street visual point of view and any other point of view, it's probably not going to put itself in your face as, you know, these guys wrap this house in vinyl.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and that's there are some areas where you can pick up some economy and still achieve the result, mm-hmm. you know, because it's a pretty nice beaded effect.
You still have the aesthetic view that you're looking for without the maintenance. Would that be something that would be allowed? Or
replacement? We're just, we're kind of checking on precedent here.
I can't remember, to be honest with you.
Because we typically, unless it's in-kind, vinyl tends to be a material.
I mean, there is currently, it's a wood beaded that's in there, and we weren't tearing, some of that was, you know, a lot of that was going to stay, I think, right? You know, all the stuff that's sort of, it's just where the soffit is blown away and whatnot.
It's got like a nice flock finish to it.
Mm-hmm. That's one of our project managers' name on there. That's what that, it's not a
brand.
Yeah.
Okay.
I borrowed that from him, and I need to return it. They tend to disappear.
Is that a possibility for the building?
Well, how does the board feel about a vinyl instead of a wood? In addition to that, aluminum for this soffit.
No, we were, and I didn't mean to.
Yeah, no, please, yeah.
We're being allowed to use that PVC material for the beam and things of that sort, and that's mm-hmm. why we propose using this along those
right.
lines. Also, you know, longevity-wise, you don't have the maintenance mm-hmm. and things of that sort, mm-hmm. so.
And again, the PVC, CPVC alternative, the AZAC or whatever, you know, that you lay it up board by board, it is more labor intensive, and you know, it wouldn't originally fit into the guys, you know, the budget and you know what we were doing mm-hmm. with the job. But we're still trying to keep it in the style and the, you know, to keep it with the timber and tone of the mm-hmm. of what you're trying to achieve in the neighborhood.
Right.
With, you know, we don't want it to stand out,
mm-hmm.
you know, cheap.
Right.
You know, so to speak, yeah.
I think because that part's not highly visible, mm-hmm. it would be very difficult from a distance to tell
ascertain.
That it's not vinyl.
Yeah, yeah.
The only thing that you might be able to see if it has a J-bead at the perimeter, that's gonna make it stand out as vinyl. But they do make mm-hmm. a bead that's kind of like a little OG shape.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And if you run that around horizontally, so actually at this condition, you wouldn't even be grabbing a hold of the end of the vinyl. You would actually just be butting it up against the bottom.
Correct.
And then just run that all the way around horizontally at the top of the beam, and that would look like a historical molding.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have I didn't bring the samples, but we have a whole pack of the AZAC, and that's, I know that's
one. You could do that. Okay.
You know, they have
all the different moldings you can pretty much get in wood. You pretty much, I'm sure you're well aware, you can get the same thing in a PVC
mm-hmm,
material.
Mm-hmm.
They have like a cove molding. They have an OG, I think, or a reverse OG or whatever.
Okay.
You know, we could supply that image, or, you know, I could write the model number down of that and send that to Amy or whatever, if
okay.
that's what you'd like.
We'd probably include that detail in the resolution.
Yeah, you can do it verbally, and then I'll provide okay. the size or
okay.
whatever it is.
And for the three-tab asphalt shingles, they are proposing the color slate, charcoal, or nickel gray. I think the executive committee said the nickel gray or the slate would be the most appropriate. So that just has to be determined.
Mm-hmm. Or just a choice. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think those colors will blend nicely.
Mm-hmm.
I think they'll be okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any other questions about material use, details?
I was trying to look at the neighbor's home and see what downspout,
mm-hmm,
if it's a two
right.
by three or round.
There's a little bit of everything on that block.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there's not a whole lot of consistency
yeah.
there.
I think, I don't know, my experience tells me round would
yeah.
probably be original.
That's probably what.
A lot of corrugated round in this photo.
This one is
mm-hmm.
rectangular.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The adjacent neighbor has a retro 2x3 that he put in there that even looks like it's an off color.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you have that photograph or not.
The blue one?
Blue one?
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that round? Did you say that?
It's rectangular,
okay.
right? It's not.
Yeah,
round.
That's probably
yeah,
okay.
a 2x3, which is a standard size. And those are okay. That would be okay as white if everything else is white.
To make a motion?
I
to approve the proposed porch alterations at 1344 Good Street. Based on the drawing information that's submitted, and that the downspout would be a corrugated round to match neighboring properties.
Can that be aluminum?
Sure.
Okay.
In painted aluminum. The soffit material to be a white vinyl as submitted in the sample, with an OG channel molding at the bottom perimeter. And the other details that match existing, that would be in-kind replacements, would essentially be approvable at staff level, mm-hmm. so they wouldn't be relevant to the resolution.
Right.
And the roofing material?
The three tab.
As submitted.
Mm-hmm.
So either of those two colors is okay?
Which were the
would there be
again?
A preference, or doesn't matter at all?
I mean, I'd probably go with slate, because normally... This is...
That was where I was leaning.
The slate, and this is nickel gray.
Slate?
Yeah, I think the nickel gray might be a little blue, yeah.
That's submitted in the slate sample.
Okay, slate.
That's everything? Yep.
I think so.
Okay.
Thanks.
Is that
right?
All right, Mr. Devine.
Yes.
Ms. Lissot.
Yes.
And Mr. Booth.
Yes.
Okay, so you're approved with those changes. Ms. Johnson will write that up. If you want some clarity, you can certainly call her to walk through that.
Sure.
Yep.
Great.
If there's anything else.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Right. Thank you. Thank Good you. Luck with your work. You. Thank you.
Thank you for all of your detailed drawings.
Yeah, appreciate that. And the patience through the process.
Yes.
You
guys can
Okay, thank you. All right, I'm sure you do.
Well, it's in the computer.
Do you want your sample back?
Yeah.
Here's your, oh, for Mr.
Yeah.
Mr.
Okay.
Mr.
Thank you.
You're
thank
welcome.
You.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, so is there an applicant for 1005 Penn Street?
Yes, my name is Gordon Bresnick. Good
okay.
evening, everybody.
Good evening. Sign in, sir. Ms. Johnson will read the property summary.
Okay. The historical integrity of this three-story Italianate row home has been compromised with the application of a brick veneer and the replacement of the front entrance door and windows on the front facade. However, the structure has retained a decorative wood cornice at the third floor roof line, an arched door surround and transom window above the front entrance door, and decorative wrought iron grates at the basement level windows. The structure received a site quality rating of 46 and is not a contributing site in the Penns Common Historic District. And tonight we are reviewing the proposal for the replacement of the front entrance door. And the Secretary of the Interior standards that apply are 2, 5, and 6, of which I read previously. Do you want to explain your project?
The door that it's existing door, it is a steel door. It's rotten. The steel is rotten also. And I say let me bring an improvement to the building and try to match the similarities what's in the block. And it happened that I came across this door that matches exactly what's across the street from new built buildings and matches the doors exactly what's in there. I don't wanted to come up with, I've been waiting for a while to come up to change the door, but I just did not think what will match what's on the block. Unfortunately, what's on the block, it's a amalgam of water.
Yeah.
Yes. So I say I'll match with, it happened that I came across this door that matches right what's built recently, mm-hmm. and it's a newer door, and well, I think will look really good on the property.
Okay, thank you. Some questions?
the door that I am providing has exactly the same outside molding as it's existing right now. Besides that, it's durable and it's made this, it's not a plastic, but it's a non-corrosive material.
Okay.
Yes.
When you say molding, you mean like that framing around the door?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Yes. It's like 1.5 inches or something like that.
Because the original entrance door is probably two double doors, the, so
yeah,
it's
likely
already been completely
altered.
Altered,
yep.
Yeah.
Now, with your recommendation, I would like to strip all the paint that is there that it's peeling off and give a good coat to the arch also and redo it the right way, in other words. I don't want to change the door because I'm not gonna, it's like wearing a suit but not changing the shoes.
Okay.
So I would like your recommendation I don't know, I think the color, I will stay with white, but I don't know the finish.
Ms. Johnson can help you with that.
Yes,
yep.
Yes, because I would like to strip the paint. There is a peeling, there's a paint over a peeling paint, and it's just not
better to do it right.
Yes.
Yep. Okay.
And you had said that the hardware was going to remain as a Deadpool lock, and it was originally like a
yes,
just a
they
round
were down
handle
on the floor. They, if you would have opened the door, that was everything in there.
So it will retain.
There's a dental
okay
lock here. This is, there's nothing there
okay
right now, I don't think, but
a round door.
A round door.
Yeah,
okay.
the whole thing, it's coming apart.
Mm-hmm.
I fixed it a while back, like 2 years ago. I put some screws outside, but they're not aesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
And now that wood that was capped by the steel, it just got rotten. So now the steel start to peel off.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not using the original doorknob, you're getting a new doorknob from the new door?
I think I'll take the new doorknobs because that's what they are.
New
they're not
deadbolt.
Yes, they're not historically. I'm a pro restoration, by the way. Yes, and I look to improve to what we used to what I found.
Do we know when the existing door was installed?
It looks old, like even from
yeah
the 70s or something.
Mm-hmm.
So when you acquired the building, the
yes
store was there. Okay.
Yes, yes.
And the problem with the existing door installation is that it's a frame inside of a frame.
Mm-hmm.
The historical frame is in place. All the casing is in place. There's beautiful molding around the original door frame. And then what they did was they packed it out.
Yes, sir.
And popped in a new frame.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. That's what
so
happened.
You have a frame inside of a frame.
Yes, sir.
We don't typically approve that. And the reason being, that would have never happened historically. The right thing to do is to take out the second frame that was installed, get back to the original frame, and have a door made that fits that frame, the original frame, and reuse the casing that you already have.
May I ask, did you already purchase the door?
Yeah.
Okay.
I wish I knew.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think that I can have that door is 36 inch. That's the biggest you can get. I believe back in the days, if I'm not mistaken, it used to be a double door.
It
what
probably
used to
was.
Be back
it's quite
on
wide.
The,
mm-hmm.
Yes. So probably somebody at one point, at one time, because these block, I think, is historical since 2005, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Right. So let me tell you something. Was done before 2005. Was done a lot of butchering to these houses.
Right.
If you look at the windows, the way they look, that's not historical. Unfortunately, it gets allowed to get down or something like that. I just seen right now, just passed by a property at 8th and Franklin on the right-hand side where that girl got killed. They just changed the windows. One of the windows is higher than the other. Underneath is plywood. It looks like, I don't know what, because the name doesn't have no.
What is the width and the height of the existing door slab?
I think it's 81 inches by 42, the whole rough opening. 41 and a half.
The door slab that's in there now is 3 feet by 6'8"?
I think it's 36, 38 inches, something like that, yeah. Because the door itself is 36 by 81. So I think the framing and everything, I think it's 36, 38, around 40 inches.
This is a difficult scenario, and I'll report on one that I looked at this week from 6 months ago that we approved. That was very similar to this.
Was it?
Mm-hmm. And it's not good. It's not historically appropriate. Mm-hmm. It was essentially an in-kind replacement, but I'll show the nuances later.
Okay.
And it's this whole business of
frames within frames, yeah.
A pre-hung door with a pre-applied brick mold slapped inside of an old frame that has casing already in place, and it's just not, it's not appropriate.
Yeah. So does your door come with a frame, or you would use the, I may have already asked this, you would
either
use?
Or.
Either or.
The door has the frame. If you look, if you see it, the door has the frame already.
Sir,
it has the frame and has the casing and, I would love to use the new one because, you know, it is it is weatherproof.
Discuss addressing that kind of condition specifically in a policy, I don't know, but given the fact that it the install is what it is and he's putting back something that's already there in the same way, even though it's a new door, and we have approved them in the past.
Yeah, even though it's not appropriate, as Aaron stated, it's still, that's what is existing.
I mean, in theory, you could take the door off the hinges and just replace the door slab, and then it would be an in-kind replacement except for the door itself.
Right.
Which we would probably approve as a board. Is the new door being painted?
No, we want to keep it the same white.
It'll just be white like
yes,
this?
Yes, it is white right now and there. I'm thinking I want to keep the same because it looks better. It looks better for the building because it's, the building has a 10 brick. The brick is...
My only comment in that case would be that the glazing bead on the two lights appears to be some kind of polymer. It's fiberglass or plastic or something, and it's just a brighter white than the rest of the door, which
I can paint it, which,
finished metal.
Yeah.
So if the whole thing were painted the same color, I think it would help it look a little bit more.
Well, that's why I ask if you can give me the approval and at your recommendation, because I want to paint. If I paint the arch, I'll need to paint the door also, because it's not going to be one shinier than the other one.
Right.
That'd probably be ideal.
I think that would help.
Yeah.
Aaron, could you clarify again what you want him to do? Like, not replace, just replace the door itself, not the whole outer frame.
I think that changes.
What's being proposed is essentially
it's
that,
yeah.
Because it's the same type of frame, the same type of brick mold. So, conceptually, it's like he's replacing just the door slab, even though he's replacing that whole frame in the brick mold. It's an unusual application because it's an existing non-conforming condition that's kind of being done in kind, but there's a slight nuance to the style of the door.
Of the door, right. Which is why we're reviewing it.
Now, I have a question. In case if I run in trouble, like let's say because the facade of the sides of the what's holding the door, it's plywood. In case if that thing gets rotten or something, what would be your recommendation to replace it with the same?
My recommendation would be take all that plywood out and get back to the original door frame, which is still there. It's under the plywood. The transom's still there. All that original frame is behind the original casing, and it's all still in place. Then once you have that frame exposed, you can measure for a new door slab and have a slab made that fits the opening. And that would be, then you're back to, you're very close to the original doors. They're just not split down the middle, which I think many of them have been changed out on that block already.
Mm-hmm. All of them.
Yeah, it was hard to find something, but
there's a few that are original.
What's the name, Mr. Christie, that passed away?
Yes.
That's it.
And up on the other end, there's a couple right below Dan's restaurant, I think.
The stone one.
They're original, yeah.
1040, 1041.
Yeah.
There is another way to do it, I've done this. You can cut the existing door frame and leave the transom in place, and then slide the new door frame in behind the casing underneath the transom, and then you just mold the two together, and it looks like it was always there. It's the size of the original door.
So recess it, you mean? When you install it, recess it back?
You just install the new frame under the existing transom frame.
Okay.
So the two line up.
Okay.
And the existing casing's already there. You don't even have to take that out.
Yeah.
You can cut it behind the casing.
But if he were to do that, he'd have to come back before the review board because it would be a different door than what he's proposing.
Would you like the opportunity to investigate that first?
To be honest with you, I spend on a door $500 that I cannot throw it away, especially right now that...
Where did you purchase the door from?
At, what's the name? Empire. Empire Supplies. They had it in there. Somebody ordered it and was
They'll refund that one then.
It was a special order by somebody and they just never picked it up, so they put it for sale and you buy them as is what is.
At a lesser price, right, than what?
Yeah, well, I paid $500 myself. I don't know how much that was the original price for it because it was a special order by somebody else. Because you're not, you don't see them doors, you know, it's not the regular...
Sure, no, I understand it. Usually when I'm in those situations, what I'll try to do is sell it again at a markup. Because they're selling it probably close to wholesale just to get rid of it. Plop it on Craigslist or Facebook Marketplace or something like that. Try and sell it for $7. And I use maybe $200. That's me because I'm a miser cheapskate. And that's what I do. But, you know...
If I would have the time, I'll be honest with you. I would do it. This door has been in this repair already the third year, and you know the cold is getting in during the winter, and it's cracking my pipes that are going up on a second and third floor, and it's just I bump it into it and I see similarities to what used to be across the street and up the block. So I say that will match to what's existing in there already.
Sure. You brought up a valid point, and that's what if the plywood is rotted? Or maybe it's close. And maybe you spend $500 on a door now and you get the door in, you make it through the winter, you know, after all the snow, and now you're in a position where the plywood's rotted. Well, there's $500.
If the plywood is rotten, I'm coming over to see you again.
Yeah, so in lieu of what Mr. Booth is saying, why not investigate having an appropriator there that matches the original style, instead of us just making a ruling today to throw the door in, and you have to redo it again maybe a year or so from now. And then you're out $500 anyway in a year's worth of time.
Do you know if the Artifacts Bank would have anything this wide?
No, without an
area.
They might have a pair of doors.
I know there's a pair, at least one pair. But I don't know what the slab measurements are. At this point, with the information I have available, I don't know how the rest of the board feels, but to your advantage, I'm almost thinking tabling the resolution to allow you time to do some research, do some measurements on that existing opening to see what can be done before we make an official ruling on this specific door.
To be honest with you, this was not in my plan to have this repair done, but since I ran into this door and I say I will have a time and found somebody to have it done the proper way. That was not in my plan, and I don't know. To be honest with you, right now, I just closed my pizza shop and I came over here. Please excuse my attire. My schedule ends tonight at 11 o'clock. You know what I'm saying? It's just so hard for me to have things done if I'm not there. Because let me tell you something, people do whatever they feel like, you know what I'm saying? And I gotta be there because I'm really specific and really detailed person, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying?
Sure,
and it's just so hard to find somebody to do work in a city of Reading. It's unbelievable. Somebody to do the proper way, I don't know how these people, they got a job. And the guy that was sitting on the left, he said that's his last job in Reading. Mm-hmm. That's why he just told me outside.
There's a few contractors that Ms. Johnson could recommend that do really good work in this situation.
I know, but who can afford that?
That's the struggle we all have. I live in the city too. I want multiple.
Things have fallen so bad. Mm-hmm. Today alone, you know how much my pizza shop made?
Sir,
$57.
Sir, we just have to stay focused on the resolution if we could, because we'd like to make a motion as a board and give you some direction going forward. Well, the board has before them, we could table this resolution. The other option is to, as we have in the past, even though none of us like the existing condition, it is existing in an in-kind installation, even though the door is different. So that's also an option as well. So the chair will entertain a motion of either or something different.
I just hate to see him install the door and then come back to us and say that the wood is rotten and he has to do something else, because we more than likely will say, now you have to go to the full-size door. So you would lose your money. Wouldn't you rather have us table it and have you check out if you can find another door that would fit here, or check what the wood situation is?
At least if that would be, let's say another, how long? 5-7 years? That'll take me through the time. At least I don't have that door that it's...
We're just asking for maybe one more month. You said the door has been in poor condition for, I think, at least 3 years, you said,
yes.
Right? And I understand you purchased a door, which, by the way, doesn't influence the board at all. The fact that you purchased something, we always try to advise property owners to not purchase anything. You can always discuss that with Ms. Johnson if she's fairly certain that the board has approved those kinds of installations or doors in the past. So we're asking you potentially to just to hold back for one more month.
With all my respect for you.
This is the motion.
considering that the door has been in poor condition for quite some time, and just ask you to take a look at that.
With all my respect for you, the only reason that I purchased the door is because I see that it's matching the what's on the block,
right?
And it's not just any you know, those little arches door. Mm-hmm. That's why I.
Yeah, and I understand that if you take a cue, and that's what we ask people, it's context in the neighborhood to see what materials are there. But what's making it complicated is the installation.
Okay.
And the fact that it is, I mean, you can see that it's a frame door within, you know, a smaller door in a frame, in a original frame, door frame. So we're just potentially asking if this is the way the board votes for one more month of your time to do some more investigation.
Okay.
Given the fact that you have waited this long, hopefully one more month isn't going to make a difference. But that's what I'm saying, if that's what the board decides to do.
Okay. I respect your decision.
Okay.
I'll move to table the COA on 1005 Penn Street, pending further investigation on installing an appropriately sized door to the existing molding that was original to the property.
I'll second.
Okay, Mr. Devine?
Yes.
Ms. Lasota?
Yes.
Mr. Booth?
Yes.
Okay, so we're gonna ask you to, can we give him some guidance in terms of, like, where?
Like the artifacts bank, I mean, the artifacts bank, and I don't know if the Restore, I haven't been in there, they don't tend to have.
They don't usually carry
stores.
Like very rare.
I think the Artifacts Bank is going to be a good resource.
Mm-hmm.
You know, architectural antique stores. There's one in Adamstown. Historical doors that were made as pairs to fit openings of this size, that's probably the most likely fit that you would be able to find as an antique. If not, we can provide some resources for door manufacturers who will make a new door slab that's sized to fit the opening. And you can get those either pre-hung in a frame and cut it in to match up with that existing frame, or the right thing would be just get the slab and hang it in the existing frame.
We can help guide you through that, sir, okay? Amy can.
Okay.
All right. Thank you very
All
much.
Right.
Thank
Thanks
you.
For your time tonight.
All right.
Thank you.
So our next applicant, 108 South Fifth Street. Want to sign in, sir?
In 1904, Schoeffer's Quality Bakery, Inc. opened an establishment at 108 South Fifth Street, which eventually expanded into the buildings located at 110 through 112 and 114 South Fifth Street. Therefore, the main structure at 108 South Fifth Street consists of two buildings as identified by two different cornice lines and different window configurations, which were combined and unified with an early 20th century commercial storefront for the bakery. Schoeffer's Bakery operated at this complex until the 1970s, after which it was vacant until Essek & Barr Insurance Incorporated purchased the buildings in the 1980s and restored the storefront, as well as demolished structures at the rear of the complex adjacent to Wood Street that were used for the preparation of commercial bakery goods. The structure features a painted brick facade, original wood bracketed cornices, and original wood windows, of which the southern portion of the building retains segmental arched windows in the upper floors. The first floor storefront features large glass windows with leaded glass transoms above them, as well as above the recessed entrances. The structure received a site quality rating of 74. A third building consists of a 2.5-story Federal-style row home featuring a brick facade and 6/6 wood windows. The structure received a site quality rating of 70, deeming it a significant contributing building in the Callow Hill Historic District. And the standards that apply to the project, which consists of the replacement of an existing tile panels with wood panels below the first floor storefront at the northern end of the building. The Secretary of the Interior standards that apply are 2, 5, and 6, of which I read previously. You want to explain your project?
You've done a fine job. We're redoing the entire facade, mostly paintwork, slight masonry repairs here and there, matching in kind. The two recessed vestibules have two different types of tile, which we're replacing in kind where it's damaged only. Mostly missing pieces, to be exact. Some of the damage from settling is actually going to stay in place. But the two things before the board tonight are the, I believe it was about a 1980s renovation when Essig and Barr did that, and the building on the north end has an 80s-ish tile on the north side as well as the east side below the storefront windows, which we're looking to remove and replace with a matching wood framing similar to the second building, 112, below the windows. So it'll be uniform and consistent from one to the next. The second item before the board is the removal of some lights above the pharmacy sign on either side of the entrance. Simple removal. Filling in the existing holes and matching up the repair of the wood as best we can, so you can't tell where those holes were.
Okay. Would that still be used as a signboard?
Below the windows?
Above the windows.
Above the windows, yes. The pharmacy has their lettering there, which is going to stay in place.
It's just not going to light it.
Correct. As far as I am aware, there are no new lights going in. If there were, that would be a separate application then.
I'm surprised you want to remove them. I actually don't mind them. If they were new fixtures, I think they would be great.
Are they not working? I don't know. If Cindy, do you know?
I don't remember seeing them lit, so I don't know.
And honestly, I have no idea. I was given the list of what to do, and here it is.
Here, yep, this is what you're doing, yeah. So there's just a couple of spots right here, just at the top, at the entrance. There's a couple of spotlights.
Correct.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Correct. It's like a rigid piece of conduit with a box on the end,
okay,
with a downward facing light.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it's probably an 80s era installation.
Mm-hmm. Makeshift gooseneck.
Yeah.
But that type of fixture, if, and maybe you want to mention this to them, if they ever did want to light their sign in the future, this is the type of lighting that we would be recommending.
That you would want.
So,
well,
maybe undoing something to have to redo in the future.
Sure. Are the existing light fixtures, I mean, they're existing, so I guess if we leave them alone, they're just fine.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of thinking, too, if someone, say this pharmacy, for whatever reason, moves out at some point in the future, and someone wants light, kind of what you're alluding to, now you're going to have to put lighting back in. Why not keep the infrastructure there so that this is not a topic of discussion years from now?
Yes. I will bring it up with the owner.
But we can't deny you wanting to remove your lighting. We're just questioning. I think it's an odd choice. But
sure.
The
no,
other.
It's,
just
a,
more of a,
it's a night of,
more of a comment.
Odd circumstances,
yeah.
Perhaps.
And then you're going to replicate that molding underneath the storefront windows to match?
Correct.
Okay. What's to the south?
Correct.
Okay.
And it's a relatively simple molding. There's not much detail to it.
Mm-hmm.
Besides the gooseneck lighting, there's also two lights like above the entrance.
That's actually what I was talking about. The two little
those
spotlights.
Are coming on.
Yeah.
And then there's also, it looks, is it a camera or something? Is that going to be removed also?
There are cameras there. To the best of my knowledge, they're not being removed.
So the cameras are remaining?
I believe so.
Okay.
Oh, there's one there too. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. I was wondering what that was.
I don't have any exceptions.
Okay. Any other questions?
I'll move to approve the COA for 108 South 5th as proposed.
Okay, is there a second?
A second.
Okay. Mr. Devine?
Yes.
Ms. Lasota?
Yes.
Mr. Booth?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Your work is approved.
Very good.
All right.
Thank you.
And then if the owner doesn't want to remove the lighting, that's fine as well.
We'll have a discussion tomorrow, I'm sure.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yep.
Have a nice evening.
staff applications.
Is there a motion to approve? A second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, other business. Preservation officers' reports on action items.
I don't have too much new to report. I did add one from the last meeting, 416, at the very bottom, 416 Douglas Street. I think Sean had reported on it that the rear roof work had not been completed, but maybe in progress. So I'll check that out. I think you'd said that not all of the roofing material had been installed. The properties in citation, the 450 South 7th Street, I'll be going to court again on August 14th. And 733 Madison, a court hearing is scheduled for July 16th. And that was the replacement of windows as well. 833 Rose Street, I was in that block a couple weeks ago or last week. And the original door that was in violation, which was an oval leaded glass door, has been removed and replaced with a panel door that actually matches its neighbors right next door, but it's like a metal or fiberglass door. So that was done without any approvals or anything. So I did take a picture, but I didn't print it out. So I guess what I should do is send a violation letter because they didn't get approval but I have to look at what the original resolution said, if it dictated what style door was mm-hmm. to be installed. But the oval leaded glass door is gone, which was the major mm-hmm. violation. Mm-hmm.
Did you know that 450 South 7th is for sale?
No.
Yeah, it's just kind of my concern too, that properties come up for sale, whether it be ongoing litigation or stuff
placed
in the past. That doesn't stay with the property.
The violation stays with the property. So if somebody knew,
it doesn't get brought up through the entire process. So then a new owner comes in and we're like, hey,
right,
that was in violation.
Right.
And they say, well,
right. Even with the history, do you think even with the history on this property and the years of citations, do you think even that would get missed in a?
It's not going to come up in like title search or anything.
No, okay. It's not, because it's not recorded anywhere.
Someone could be stepping into something really challenging.
Yes.
Yeah.
When it goes to the transfer department, it won't come out there
either. Yeah, no.
It'll just slip right through, and then after closing, oops, guess what you bought.
Because there's no legal way, it's not like a lien we put on it or anything like that. But yeah, you're right. But I have dealt with many property owners and explained to them, unfortunately, the violation stays with the property. And we have had property owners correct violations, but it's a good point. I don't know, because I don't have the opportunity to talk to anybody who's buying the building. They just show up and want to do work.
Or if they're savvy enough to ask the right questions, and hope that a potential seller is truthful in what they're telling them.
Well, that's the thing. It's a commercial property, so there's no seller disclosure.
Oh, okay.
It's not like a residential
disclosure. Okay.
So there's no seller disclosures on commercial properties?
No, that's for residential only. I mean, there's things that you can do, but it's not what you're used to seeing for residential.
Okay.
So it has to be written up in the contract on the buyer's side. I don't think there's a field for that in the commercial agreement. Okay. To double check.
Are there property inspections that are prior to transfer?
Not for commercial?
There's a due diligence period, which is blanket for research, whatever you want to research.
But that's on the buyer, though, right? Right. But I mean, the city doesn't require any kind of property inspections.
Only post-sale.
Okay.
That's what's required. It could be requested to be done pre-sale, but that's part of the buying process.
Yeah, that's a problem. And it's supposed to be disclosed that they're in a historic district, at least. That's part of the settlement papers.
Residential.
Not for commercial.
Again, there's no disclosure report for commercial property.
Okay.
You have something filled out that's at the owner's discretion, not necessarily required.
Do any other departments put liens on properties? Building codes?
I don't know. I'm not sure because I hear different things that it's not not a usual practice just because of the time it takes and the low staffing in the building, but I'm not absolutely sure. I know trades, like if a building is demolished, a lien should be placed on it for the cost of the demolition.
Right.
I'm not sure if
code tags. So not so popular anymore as a quality of life violation. Yeah. Mm-hmm. When those have added up to circumstantial amounts, you would see those come up.
Oh, okay.
For being past due. Trying to think of some other stuff that I've seen. But that's one.
I'm just wondering if that would be a way, if we go through the court system and it comes back again, rather than continuing to cycle through over and over, couldn't that be like a second or a third pass? The city just puts a lien on it.
Right. But how would you determine, like, an amount?
I don't know. You'd have to estimate the value of the work.
Mm-hmm. Right. And you had asked a question, which I'm still looking into. I did send an email, but I haven't gotten a response back about the money, like when people plead guilty and pay the fine, whether that goes to the court system or if any of it comes back to the city. I'm almost certain it just goes to the court system. It's not, but I'm still waiting for an answer on that.
Right, so the lien would also help to mitigate some of that administrative overhead.
Right.
Of continuing to process repetitive citations.
Because I have hundreds of hours into 450 South Second Street.
Yeah, of course you do, over a long period of time.
That's just me. There's other people that have worked on it as well.
Yeah. Is that a follow-up with legal? You want to...
About
the question?
The cost of,
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I've actually posed the question to the codes manager because they deal with the court system a lot more than I do. Mm-hmm. But, yeah. So I'm just waiting for him to respond.
Okay.
I think the same holds true with inspection funds, too.
Oh, okay.
Like if you don't pay your multi-unit permit.
Okay.
I think that adds up over a while, and then
a lien.
Well, it gets deducted from closing costs, so it's basically a lien.
So that's making it into the system somehow.
Yeah.
It must be. I have no idea if it's entered into. I can ask the codes manager about liens on properties and how they're determined.
Because it's that transfer process where they investigate and say, hey, your multi-unit permit hasn't been paid for the year. You owe $150 up front, and I'm a closing cost, whatever.
What is it called, the multi-unit?
No, the permit fee that you have to pay every year, or the inspection fee you have to pay every 3 years.
That's probably like one of the line items when codes goes into looking at the history of a property, I'm guessing, in our Hansen system. It might be like a line item, they can just open it up and see that it wasn't paid.
Mm-hmm.
And then it comes out. But
I don't know how that system works, if it's possible to do like a $0 line item, something like that.
Yeah.
Just so it pops up and there's a violation.
Yeah, I'll ask him how the process works.
We may be required to have an ordinance amendment to impose a penalty like that, a monetary penalty, an adjustment to the fee schedule.
Yeah, because right now it's just a violation.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But that's okay. I think it would be appropriate. I mean, even if you just quantified the time that you put into each one, mm-hmm. I'm sure that amounts to several hundred dollars at least.
Easily.
Yeah, minimum. Did you have a question? No, okay, okay, so board member reports on resolutions, and then Amy probably has some new ones.
I have two, but you're gonna get off easy because.
Oh, okay. We'll take it.
And I'll explain when.
Okay. So Mr. Devine, did you have any?
Be honest with you, I think they got buried under some other guests.
Oh, okay. If you need some verification, you can ask Amy about those, okay?
Yeah. All right. I know I have some. There's a lot of paper.
But she would know which one's like for the month.
Okay.
Yeah.
Depends. Sometimes it gets mixed up, like people don't do them right away or something.
Okay.
But yeah.
Okay. All right.
So I have one.
Okay.
230 and 232 South 6th Street. It was to replace the three-tab asphalt shingle siding in the rear of the property with CertainTeed triple 3-inch clapboard. They were working on the property when I went by, so it wasn't finished, but I did take a picture of it. Mm-hmm. The only thing I don't remember, did they ask for a window in the back? It looked like it was a new window, but I'm not sure. And I didn't see anything in the resolution about a window.
Can I see the picture?
I mean, it looked like it had the sticker still in, that it was in the top portion of the window.
Actually, this is not the building. 230 and 232 is at the end. And actually, I just got a building permit for this property. And Trades, Zoning, and I have been exchanging emails, and Trades told me that they told them that they needed approval, so they don't have approval for this work. And actually, I've been wanting to get out here to see, because they don't have a permit for it. So
and that's not the root. See, it's hard to tell. There's no way to judge where the property is.
And 230 and 232 are at the very end up towards the school. There's a vacant lot. And they're right on the end. But I can tell you, I have been out there, and he did do it correctly. That property owner has come to me multiple times and checked with me and made sure that he's doing everything correctly, and he's been very...
Well, it looks like both of these properties were done with siding.
No, I'm very glad that you took this, because I haven't been able to take time to get out there and look at this. But the owner...
And when I was there, he was working with, like, cement underneath the... paneling.
The owner was told that he had to buy the building inspector that he had to get approval before, but as and in our discussion we stated that they don't, even though they're told that, they don't always come and do that, and he does not have a signed building permit
yet.
Did
they stop work with her or anything?
No.
Because there was somebody you'll see in the picture working back there.
Okay. The trouble is I don't know what was here before.
Well, shouldn't there be photos in the file from the application for the neighboring
property?
That's
true, yeah. Oh, and this.
So cross out the address on there. That's not the address.
Okay. Yeah, this is like 238 or 236, I think. But yes, I know for certain that this, the 230 and 232 was done correctly, because I've been out there myself. But I'm gonna have to, call them. The building that the resolution is for is up at the other end of the block, so I don't know pictures, but it's just so frustrating, because I know, I have an email from the building inspector saying I told him that he needed to get approval, but if they're meeting the build, I have to have a discussion with trades, because if they're meeting the building code, they're not putting a stop work order on it. But technically, I'm not authorized to put a stop work order on buildings. They have to for me, so
but
I have
at
to.
Your, if you authorize them to do so, we talked about another application in our in last week's executive committee meeting where you sent out a building inspector and everything to him looked fine, but in fact, you sent him out for express purpose to stop work, and he said, I didn't see anything wrong. So some of that, I'm sure, is education, too, always an uphill battle.
But I'm assuming this is probably, it was a frame building. I don't know what was on it, but we did allow 230 and 232 to put siding on the frame portion of the building, but...
And the other part looks like it's brick, but they have ladders by that, as though they might be covering that part of the building, too.
Or painting. I don't know. I'll have to
go out and see that, I guess.
But thank you. I'm glad you picked the wrong building, because I have not, like I said, been able to get out there. So I will address it. Even if it's there, they have to come before the review board next month.
Okay, so I had a couple. One of them's an older one, so this is the one that I reached back and got. Okay, this is 144 North Fifth Street. It's for the replacement of six existing wood windows with six white aluminum clad windows and the removal of six aluminum storm windows, the second and third floor front facade. So I went out to look at the property. There are definitely new windows there. Now, the resolution says that he would have come back and gotten approval. It's Miguel's property.
From what I could tell, he had installed everything. Appropriately.
The only thing is, I mean, they're all covered with. They all have screens on them. So all I really saw were screens. The windows, I assume that he did what he was supposed to, but the profile of the windows very, very narrow.
And that's what they were.
Is that
before?
What they were? Yes. Okay. All right. That's the one detail that I noticed. It was actually almost difficult to see the window frame. Because it was so narrow, especially that bottom, the bottom sash, the lower area was.
I remember they were very narrow.
Then it appears as if he did all of that correctly then. Okay, all right. And then there were two resolutions on this next property. It's 1818 Lorraine Road, where it was the enclosure of the existing carport, of which he did correctly, did the carport correctly. And the second resolution was a violation on the double hung windows that he had installed, and we had passed a resolution for him to put in better proportioned windows that match the windows in the rest of the house. But in the meantime, I understand he appealed that to council, and the decision was for him to be able to retain the windows.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. All
yes.
Right.
And I think he was putting in, are there sliding? Windows
yeah.
on the end?
I believe they are.
Because I think he was able to retain...
Because he had these windows. He put those in.
I think council had approved him to put in the sliding windows on the... I'd have to look.
I know that they have a mullion. They're split. So
okay.
I'm fairly
vertically.
Sure that they're...
Horizontally.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, excuse me. Vertically. Yes, okay. Vertically. Yep. So they slide horizontally, but the mullion is vertical.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's what council had approved.
Okay. All right.
For him, but the board had said two windows, but council approved him to have three windows,
and which is what is installed right now.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. There you go. I think
that's what I remember anyway. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Booth, did you have any?
Yes. Okay. So I reviewed 144 North Fifth Street, which was the replacement of an existing full glass door with a new full glass door. And this is the one that I was referring to during the previous application. So I'll show you. This is the H&R Block.
Yes, the same one that she's just...
It's the one that I...
The windows.
So that's the new door that was installed.
Okay.
And
that door entrance had been
You can see the brick mold. That's a pre-applied brick mold. And there's a gap at the top, so the height is not correct for the existing opening.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, I wasn't aware that this would have a pre-applied brick mold. But in the event that it does, really, the brick mold and the frame should be white, and the door should be the thing that's made to look like stained
wood. Right, right.
Yeah, I don't
remember.
That's
the new door.
Okay. You're talking about this part up here?
Yes, the brick mold is the molding on the perimeter. That's the brick mold.
I thought
it was keeping. Yeah, you can see a gap at the top.
He was just replacing the door, mm-hmm. but I'd have to look at the resolution.
It's like stepped out.
But I don't remember. Yeah.
So this is, unfortunately,
can I see it more closely? Yeah.
It seems to be an issue that is recurrent. And I think the address numbers were also installed because they're satin nickel and they appear to match the hardware on the door.
They look very new.
Right. Mm-hmm. But I don't think that was part of the resolution.
I don't think so either.
So that was the first one. Second one was for South 6th Street, and it was a violation for replacement of two windows on the third floor with vinyl.
Okay.
That was denied, and nothing's been done to correct it.
Okay, then I'll send a letter.
And the signage that was part of that resolution was not completed.
Okay. Yes.
Is it? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Building. Yep.
Yeah, and it had all original
yes,
wood windows.
That's right. Yeah.
And then the current owner has replaced two of them.
Right.
Did the resolution for 144 North Fifth Street, was it just the replacement of the, if you have that?
I believe so.
Of the door, not the brick mold around it? I thought it was just for the door. That's what I recall.
Right.
And nothing about house numbers either.
It just talks about the door itself. It doesn't talk about brick mold. And it mentions the hardware being a Schlage lock set, Latitude with Century style in a satin nickel finish, which is, I guess, what was proposed.
Yeah.
I think really it probably would have been more appropriate as satin brass.
Mm-hmm. So it was just for the door. It wasn't that there was going to be a new framing around it, right?
But it's a pre-hung door, so I don't know. You'd have to go back to the minutes and see if there was any discussion about whether or not the brick mold.
Yeah.
It's not mentioned in the resolution.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it might be on the product data that he submitted to.
But I think it was a good point that was made that we don't have a door policy. We should work on that. But addressing an existing non-conforming condition where there is an argument that could be made that you would put back something that's there that's not non-conforming,
mm-hmm.
but in that scenario, you're replicating a condition that's never going to be historically
right,
appropriate.
Right.
And I just, that's, it's unfortunate to see a brand new installation that looks like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That was a tough one, but it was still, I think we were really kind of in conflict about what the right thing was to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because, right, it's not just like material, it's installation. You're right, it's a non-conforming mm-hmm. Condition, so that just creates a different level. It's just a dynamic going on. Yeah.
And that opening is even more difficult because it's similar to the one that we looked on Penn Street,
mm-hmm.
but it's been modified so many
mm-hmm.
times.
Mm-hmm.
It's stepping back repeatedly.
Yeah.
It's almost like it got sized down once and then maybe
again.
And maybe another time
Who knows?
After that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And that those original doors could be, long gone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
I've
tried to find photographs of that building, and I've never seen an older photograph now. No, because in my 1978 file photos,
mm-hmm.
it was changed.
It's been heavily modified.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You can see on the other side of the door, you can see all the the newer framing. Mm-hmm. They had, because they were, he was doing renovations, so it's not all nicely enclosed or anything on mm-hmm. the back side of the
okay,
door. You
okay.
can totally see that it
yeah.
was framed out.
Yeah, yeah. And then the windows being modified, that would have really just been probably 1/1.
Yeah.
Or was there, would there have been stained glass in the arch? I don't know.
I don't know.
Something about
there
the window condition
was.
Didn't look,
yeah.
he even said they were changed.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So,
okay. All right. I don't have any update from the Education or Outreach Committee. Policy Committee, have anything to report?
It was completely my fault that we couldn't meet this month.
Okay.
It was.
You're admitting that to everybody.
Yeah.
It's the way it is,
yeah.
right?
Please don't let my wife see this.
Sorry.
Not professional. Yeah. I think this is live. There's no bleeping.
Yeah, you know, this is my schedule. It's
okay.
just crazy. Unfortunately, 24 hours notice, you agreed to cancel or reschedule. It's just
okay.
crazy cold.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, but we'll reschedule for July.
Okay. All right. And then I just have one last question. You don't have to name any names, but do you have any update on potential board
I do
member
not.
Appointees? Okay.
Yeah, but
okay.
I can inquire.
Okay. And
oh,
you said there was
yes,
a gentleman that you came across that might express some interest, like maybe fill the trades position?
Oh, yes. The
yeah.
the previous chief building official. But
oh, right. Okay.
He's been on vacation.
Okay.
And
all right.
he hasn't contacted
okay.
me, and he retired, so I was giving him some room. But yes,
oh, right.
yes,
okay.
he,
yes,
he did express
okay.
interest.
All right.
And I forgot, the two that I have from that were to be distributed from December 2018. The first, there's only two resolutions, and the first was for 625 North Fifth Street, and that was where the owner came for financial hardship for the replacement of the slate shingles on the turret roof, and the board denied them. They in turn appealed to City Council, and City Council upheld the decision of the board. And since then, a permit has been pulled for replacing the slate shingles on the turret
okay,
roof.
Great.
So I don't know if it's completed, if
okay.
you've noticed it
you
or
said
not.
625?
625 North 5th.
Okay.
That's the only thing I'm not sure of if it has been done. Okay. And
okay.
the other one was for 621 Chestnut Street, the garages that were demolished without approval.
Oh.
And the owner contacted
oh, right,
me
right.
On June 5th.
Yeah. Just
back sorry,
yeah,
sorry,
yeah.
Sorry,
yeah.
Like on Plum
okay,
Street
that one.
There.
Yep. Yeah. That whole recessed area
yes.
back there. Yep, yep.
She contacted me on June 4th and said she's working on her plan and she hopes to submit it for July, and she's working on putting color samples together. So she has contacted me. I'm just waiting
okay.
for her to submit. So,
sounds
so
promising.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah,
yeah,
yeah. That's
yeah.
movement forward. So
yeah.
that's good. Yeah.
Definitely. And she gave me a couple of violations in the 600 block of Chestnut that
okay.
I have to
thank
deal
you.
With too. So. So,
we like
yeah.
watch business.
So I will look into those.
Okay.
But yeah, if you could check out 625 North Fifth Street and let me know.
Mm-hmm.
But the work should be done or will be done. Definitely.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
All right.
I don't have anything.
Motion to adjourn?
So moved. Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Yeah.
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Have a great evening.
Thank you.
Yes, you too.